Hi, Kevin. Thank you so much for joining us for Hoya Gateway's virtual Power Lunch interview.
My pleasure.
Well, thank you so much for being here. We're so excited to ask questions from Georgetown students today to learn about your career. A little bit about Kevin before we get started. Kevin Clark is a senior counsel at Wilkie Farr & Gallagher's litigation department. Over 35 years, Kevin has worked with a wide spectrum of complex civil litigation, investigations, and hearings with clients in a variety of industries, including aerospace, automobile manufacturing and marketing, television, entertainment, sports equipment, and pharmaceuticals. In addition to Kevin's professional career, he is deeply involved as an alumnus in the Georgetown community, currently serving as Secretary of the Board of Regents, volunteering with the Alumni Admissions Program, serving on his class committee in varied capacities to support reunions, and supporting student accessibility through Georgetown Scholarship Program sponsorships and through Hoya Gateway's Executive Committee. And now we'll dive right into questions. Kevin, the first question we have here is, what is your best advice for a college junior hoping to get into a top law school?
Well, thanks, GA. I think the most important thing as a junior is to do as best, obviously do well as you can academically. Those grades, law schools, much like colleges, look for ascending patterns in your grades. So you want to work really hard and challenge yourself with difficult courses as a junior. But it's also equally important to focus on studying very hard for the LSAT exam, which you, of course, you need to take to get into law school. While it doesn't carry the same weight as your grades or your activities, it's still an important feature in the application process. And it's something that you can completely control in the sense of preparing for it by investing the time in getting review books, signing up for a review course, and so forth.
Kevin, what type of work experiences would you recommend pursuing after undergrad and before law school?
I think the most important thing is to follow your passion and to get experience in what you're interested in and somehow distinguish yourself as unique. Law school, unlike other medical school or other technical backgrounds, doesn't require any particular type of educational background or work experience. It's much more you want to show the law schools and ultimately show your clients that you are a well-rounded person, that you care about hopefully people as well as other intellectual pursuits, and that you're following that passion in your time before law school. The law schools understand that and look for people who really care about things, care about people, and follow their passions.
Great. And what course of action do you recommend for someone interested in a narrower field of law, such as international trade law?
I think in that circumstance, two things are important. Number one, law school is very expensive, so you want to be sure it's what you want to do. And secondly, if it's near you think you're interested in, the best thing to do would be to find a way to work or to volunteer in a capacity that gives you some experience and expertise in the field, even if it's not in a legal sense. That way you'll be able to have a meaningful conversation when you start interviewing, and you'll also be able to confirm that that's something you think you'd really like to do once you do become a lawyer.
Thank you for sharing that. What tips or advice do you have for someone who will be job searching post-law school, especially during this time?
I think the most important thing, whether in this time or otherwise, but particularly now, is networking. Obviously, during the period of the pandemic, much of that has to be done remotely. But through tools like Hoya Gateway and LinkedIn, you can strategically approach your job search efforts and look at a broad field of options. You don't necessarily need to limit yourself to one particular employer or even type of employers. But I think now, with all of the tools that are available over the internet, you can still pursue that. I think it's very important to try to distinguish yourself in whatever type of written submission you make. If you can write a very effective cover letter, that's always helpful. I know that it's very difficult when lots of people are submitting electronic resumes, but anything you can do to make yourself catch the eye of the people who are reviewing those and sorting them will, I think, give you also an advantage.
Really great advice. And thank you for the Hoya Gateway plugin. I think that this is the perfect time to say that there are over 10,000 Hoyas on board. Really want to help each other for professional development there.
Absolutely.
The next question we have here is, what are the toughest decisions you have to make in your job?
I think there are really two kinds. One is professional and one is interpersonal. On the professional level, the hardest decisions to make are, as a lawyer and particularly a litigator like I am, you're obligated under the professional rules to zealously represent your client's interests.
But sometimes issues arise where you understand that you might do something that's in the client's interest, but in fact it would be unethical or it would be improper under the rules. And those are hard decisions, but I think ones people always feel the best about if you make the right decision, which is you simply tell your client, I cannot do that because that would be unethical or improper or misleading to a court or to other parties. On the interpersonal level, the hardest decisions to make, I think, when you work in any organization, including a law firm, particularly as you get more senior and you have management responsibilities, is to make decisions to fire people or to let people go. Those are always difficult in any job. But I think one of the things you learn is that there are times when that's appropriate and it's not going to be the end of that person's career or their lifetime. In most cases, you become friends with people you work with, and those are difficult circumstances to deal with. But I think if you build the kind of reservoir of trust with people you work with over time, if and when that time ever comes, they'll understand that you're doing it both because it's something that's necessary for business reasons, but also something that you don't feel good about because you continue to be their friend.
Thank you for sharing that with us, Kevin. Mm-hmm. Has the current climate with COVID-19 protests, upcoming elections, and more halted your current workflow, or has your business remained relatively fluid? Assuming if you've had to work from home, that this maybe have negatively impacted workflow, but have other events like protests and the election stalled business?
Fortunately, I guess in my circumstance and that of my colleagues, it has not slowed down at all. In litigation, which is the area I specialize in, matters tend to go on for some period of time. And so I'm still very busy on matters that started well before the COVID-19 pandemic. Having said that, there are some aspects of the practice of law which have slowed down. For example, mergers and acquisitions, deal work where people have to spend time together negotiating in person. Those have slowed down somewhat, I know, in the legal community. And also, it's much more difficult now with the stay-at-home orders to spend time with your clients and to try to develop new business. So that part, you know, over time will slow down. But on the other hand, people still have needs, legal needs, whether they're transactional or litigation-based or otherwise, or just consulting. And so to the extent they're continuing to do their work, they're still going to need lawyers. So thanks to technology, we've been able to do a lot of what we otherwise would do if we were in the office, although it is somewhat frustrating at times not to be able to spend time in person with your colleagues and to just sit and talk through issues other than by Zoom or by telephone.
That's definitely the pain felt across the board for many. Kevin, what fields of litigation do you think will prosper in the next 5 to 10 years?
I think there are a number. It's interesting. Litigation, things go through cycles. And at any given time, there may be a particular area that's very hot. Right now, an area that's very busy is the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act investigation practice, where American companies or subsidiaries of American companies working abroad can be subject to criminal and civil sanctions if they engage in, for example, bribing government officials for business. And while that's very much taboo in the United States and everyone here understands you don't do that, when you're a subsidiary of a U.S. company and your employees all grew up in a country where that may be commonplace, it's very difficult to train people not to do that and to prevent it. So as a result, the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission, the Department of Justice are very active in investigating companies, subsidiaries, and employees in other countries who engage in that kind of improper conduct. That's very busy right now. In 5 years, it may be something else. I think a few areas that are going to be very active are the area of privacy, where it's many firms now are working very diligently in that area because there are so many laws and so many regulations across so many countries and states that are different, and you have to try to reconcile those for clients and try to protect your clients' privacy interests, as well as all of the people who are currently trying to hack into people's systems. That I think that area of law will be busy for some time to come. I also think intellectual property law is going to be very busy as people continue to invent more and more different kinds of things, particularly in the pharmaceutical and technological areas, that there will continue to be disputes growing between competitors who are engaged in those fields. And that, I think, those will both be very active areas.
Thank you. What can Georgetown students do to make the most of their time before they go into their career?
I think the most important thing while you're at Georgetown is to volunteer, to take advantage of all the activities and educational opportunities the university has to offer. As you know, I went to Georgetown, my wife went to Georgetown, all of our 5 children went to Georgetown, and many of our best friends are people we met at Georgetown. And I have to say the ones who really got the most out of it are the ones who invested the most in their time there, whether it be an internship on Capitol Hill or whether it be joining in various different organizations. My son, for example, who just graduated, was very involved with the rock climbing club. Whatever it is your passion is, I would encourage you to do it because you're going to grow from that experience, both in terms of your inner relationship with other people and from the enjoyment you get from what you're doing. And then I think similarly outside the university, it's important to volunteer if you can and you're so motivated to help others in the community, because that will be something you'll want to be doing as part of your lifelong experience.
Thank you so much for sharing that, Kevin. And finally, what advice do you have for Hoyas who just graduated this past year?
I think the most important thing, particularly if you either haven't been able to find a job or you've lost a job, to hang in there. There are a lot of other people in the same boat. You will have a very long and successful career. Or if you have a job and you're going to have to start out working remotely, it may be somewhat awkward since you don't really know the people you're working with. But just to hang in there and give it time. The average person who's 20 or 21 years old now, 50% of them will live to be 100 years old. Now projected, many of them will continue to work until they're 75 or 80. And while you may not have to do that, you may be fortunate enough not to need to, you may want to. So you need to look at the entire spectrum of your career and not be too obsessed with what's going on right now or too depressed about what's happening. You're going to have a long, successful time working, and you know there are going to be fits and starts and bumps in the road, and this is just one of them. But the very fact you're a Georgetown student, you're graduating now, you have tremendous education, which will open a lot of doors for you, and to just hang in there and give it time. Don't stress over it too much.
Well, thank you so much for sharing that message of resilience and the importance of remembering that the Hoya community is there for you. Do you have any last words of advice before we sign off today, Kevin?
Only I would encourage everyone to very much use Hoya Gateway, to use it as a resource. All of us who are alumni who've signed up to be on Hoya Gateway absolutely love helping and mentoring Georgetown students and recent alums. I've done that with many, many students myself and find it very rewarding. I think the students find it helpful. Not going to be a panacea for all of your needs, but I think particularly if you can network very broadly across the Hoya Gateway network as well as other available networks, you're going to find that you'll meet people who can help you throughout your life and throughout your career, both personally and professionally, and you should avail yourself of that opportunity.
Thank you so much, Kevin.
My pleasure, and good luck to everybody.